I don't think I would be able to speak about Sosma, although I had in hand in drafting it, as good as what the first speaker had spoken about. But let me see this in a different manner. The trouble with laws generally is this, even good laws for the matter. It is the interpretation and the implementation of that laws which sometimes cause problems rather than law itself. Now, let's look at this. What was our legal response to terrorism and other threats to national security? And that was by way of two forms. Firstly, it is the coercive response to combat and destroy all the terrorists and their support network. However, anti-terrorism measures will not succeed through the use of force alone. Now, what is the second step? In line with the principle of the rule of law, the response is through criminal justice system. This entails the arrest, prosecution, and conviction of the terrorists. This is based on the fact that terrorist acts are criminal acts, and all terrorists should be brought to court for trial in accordance with the law. However, such offenses are a special category, and they justify the use of special laws. This is the reason the Security Offences Special Measures Act of 2012, or commonly known as Sosma, was enacted. Now, let's look at the Sosma legal framework. In order to enable legal action against terrorism to succeed, a holistic plan and methodology needs to be established. This is to train and familiarize investigating officers, prosecuting officers, and judges on applicable laws, the elements of crime that need to be proven, the evidential requirements to prove an offense in court, available ways and means to gather the evidence required, the gravity of the offense concerned, but last and not least, the commensurate penalty that should be imposed. Now, this includes the interoperation of general criminal laws, such as the Penal Code, the Criminal Procedure Code, and the Evidence Act of 1950, with specific criminal procedural laws like SOSMA. This is, in particular, in relation to the modes of gathering and tendering of evidence, the need to protect the confidentiality of intelligence, information, and sources, as well as the need to protect witnesses. In addition, all parties need to be aware of the human rights of the accused as enshrined in the Federal Constitution. This includes the safeguards under, firstly, Article 5.1, that, and I quote, "No person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty save in accordance with the law," end quote. And that under Article 5.3, Clause 3, that, and I quote, "Where a person is arrested, he shall be informed as soon as may be of the grounds of his arrest, and shall be allowed to consult and be defended by a legal practitioner of his choice," end quote. Nevertheless, these are not absolute rights. Therefore, inroads may be made on those rights in accordance with the Federal Constitution, under Article 149 of the Federal Constitution. The preamble to the SOSMA recites the rationale for its enactment under the special powers of Article 149, which states as follows. Remember, I said the preamble states the rationale. It doesn't go further. Now, the new act was used for the first time in the case of Yazid Sufat, Halima binti Hussein, and Muhammad Helmi bin Hussein to investigate offences under Section 130GA of the Penal Code, namely promoting the commission of terrorist acts. As a result of investigations, all three were charged in court in early February 2013. However, because of a challenge on technical issues regarding the authority to use SOSMA for offences committed outside the jurisdiction of Malaysia, all three accused were discharged by the court. And I'll leave it as such. Now, along with that, with the SOSMA, I think very little is known that there were also guidelines that were drafted for the authorities to use. Those guidelines are for the enforcement of how to arrest, and including electronic monitoring device, guideline for notification of next of kin, guideline to access to detainees of prisoners, and so on. I will not go into the contents of it at the moment. Now, what are the safeguards in the SOSMA? SOSMA was introduced to deal with terrorism and other security offences, but it was never intended to suppress political dissent. As a safeguard, in subsection 4, clause 3 of the Act expressly provides for. Nor was it intended to guillotine attempts to uphold the parliamentary democracy as opposed to activities detrimental thereto. There's a difference as to those two items. When SOSMA was first enacted, the first schedule to the Act only contained two security offences, offences against the state as contained in Chapter 6 of the Penal Code, and terrorism offences as contained in Chapter 6A of the Penal Code. Hence, the original intention was clear. It was to deal with terrorism and terrorist acts. Bear in mind that SOSMA was enacted in the wake of the revocation of the proclamations of emergency under Article 150, of the federal Constitution, and the repeal of the Internal Security Act of 1950 and the related preventive laws such as the Restricted Residence Act 1933 and the Banishment Act of 1959. Again, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to remind you that SOSMA was drafted for procedural matters. And basically, if you look at it, it was to repeal it. Some of the elements in ESCA, if you remember that particular law, it's an essential security, some of our procedures laws. Yeah. Now, that particular law was, I think I would say, a bit more harsh. If you are tried under those laws, even the hearsay evidence can be admitted. But we have not used it for a long, long time. And with that, in 2012, we repealed this, and SOSMA was used. There was only one occasion which I used that, ESCA, only for one purpose, and that was to transfer the case of Aul Mauna from Perak to Kuala Lumpur. Only using that, I couldn't use for 180, for obvious reasons, because of the court decisions. So I had to use that particular law at that particular time. But not for the trial. We told the court that we are not going to rely on all the other provisions. We relied only on that part of ESCA for the transfer because of security reason. The same way what we did with the present case in that is being tried in Kota Kinabalu, the offense was committed in my town, Lahad Datu. And we of course, the hearing at the High Court would be in Tawau, but we needed to transfer it to Kota Kinabalu for security reasons, and that was done. Ladies and gentlemen, let me explain again on this. The explanatory statement to the SOSMA bill, if you look at the bill, it is all out there and open. I'm not disclosing any secrets or whatever. You have a look at it. Okay, read. What does it say? And it says this. And I quote, the proposed Security Offences Special Measures Act of 2012 seeks to provide for special measures in dealing with security offences as defined in the proposed Act. The proposed Act seeks to repeal the Internal Security Act of 1960 while recognizing the grave risk to internal security and public order presented by the threat of terrorism, sabotage, and espionage. Thus, the proposed Act is made under Article 149 of the Federal Constitution. Now, look at that, the extended scope. Inroads on this intentional, limited scope was considered in 2014 through the Security Offences Special Measures Amendment of 2014. arising from the need to deal with the rise of violent organized criminal group activities and, of course, human smuggling syndicates. The definition of security offences was extended to include offences under the new chapter of 6B of the Penal Code, Organized Crime, and Part 3A of the Anti-Trafficking in Persons and Anti-Smuggling of Migrants Act of 2007. However, these extensions do not change the fundamental purpose of SOSMA, to my mind. Its provisions are intended to deal with offences which undermine the security of Malaysia. This is made clear in the long title, which reads, and I quote, "An act to provide for special measures relating to security offences for the purpose of maintaining public order and security." Now let's now move on to the safeguards against misuse and abuse, which we are very concerned about. I just would like to remind you, and I would like, I'm not giving you something new. I'm just quoting from the Hansard. Now, what does it say? Firstly, this was all enumerated in the Hansard by the Prime Minister himself, and in gist, after that, I'll quote you exactly. Firstly, as provided under subsection 4, clause 3, no person shall be arrested and detained under this section solely for his political belief or political activity. And secondly, section 4 and so on. But let me just, what I'm going to do is, I'll just read to you the relevant parts of the Hansard. It is in Bahasa Malaysia, so pardon me for that. The relevant extracts of the Prime Minister, and that, of course, the Minister of Finance speech in Parliament during the tabling of SOSMA Bill on the 16th of April 2012 are as follows. You can go into the website, and the Parliament's website, and you can read all this. But unfortunately, most of us don't read handsets. I don't know for what reason. I don't want to say anything. Oh, terrible. Let me read this, and I quote. Melalui pindaan, pemansuhan, dan pengubalan undang-undang yang sedang berjalan, kerajaan mahu memastikan ruang demokratik mencukupi disediakan untuk perbezaan pendapat serta persaingan idea. Pucuk pangkalnya, kita mahu mencipta sebuah Malaysia di mana prinsip hak asasi manusia dijunjung. Kebebasan individu untuk berhimpun secara aman dan untuk menyatakan pendapat secara terbuka diraikan seraya kepentingan individu dan komuniti diimbangi. Berdiri di muka gerbang semua ini, segala-galanya kita mampu gemblengkan kerana kita yakin bahawa ini adalah perkara yang betul dan wajar untuk dilakukan. Apa yang penting, setiap hak maupun kebebasan mestilah bersulam dengan tanggungjawab, dengan izin, freedom with responsibility. Jadinya hari ini amat bersejarah dalam menyisir susur galur demokrasi Malaysia. Pentadbiran kini yang sentiasa prihatin merasai denyut nadi rakyat yang sentiasa mendengar keluh kesah mereka. Kita hakikatnya telah memasuki era demokrasi yang lebih matang di mana peranan kerajaan berubah daripada menjadi penentu dan pengukur tahap kematangan rakyat kepada pelindung agar mereka dapat menikmati hak-hak asasi yang sepatutnya. And I go on. Negara bukan sahaja memerlukan perisai iaitu kematangan politik rakyat tetapi juga pedang di dalam bentuk rang undang-undang keselamatan 2012. Rang undang-undang ini mewujudkan langkah-langkah khas yang diperlukan untuk menangani kes-kes keselamatan seperti yang terkandung dalam bab 6 kanun keseksaan. Rang Undang-Undang Kesalahan Keselamatan 2012 digubal di bawah lembayung perkara 149 Penembagaan Persekutuan. Keluasan diberi kepada kerajaan untuk menggubal perundangan yang tidak selaras dengan perkara-perkara 5 dalam perkara kebebasan diri. Perkara 9 berkaitan larangan buang negeri dan kebebasan bergerak. Perkara 10 berhubung kebebasan bercakap, berhimpun dan berpersatuan, serta perkara 13 tentang hak terdapat harta. So all this was explained to the MPs. The Prime Minister went on. But bear with me for a while. Listen to this again. Di bawah perindaan undang-undang ini, aktiviti menjejaskan demokrasi berparlimen ditafsirkan sebagai satu aktiviti yang dilakukan oleh seorang atau kumpulan orang dengan tujuan untuk menggulingkan atau melemahkan demokrasi berparlimen dengan cara yang ganas dan tidak berlandaskan perlembagaan. So, this now he has described that. Yeah? And I go on. Secara mudahnya, jika ada mana-mana rakyat Malaysia sama ada individu, kumpulan atau parti politik berhajat mengubah teras asas memerintah negara iaitu demokrasi berparlimen kepada misalnya pemerintahan yang bersifat teokratik, mereka haruslah menggunakan cara-cara yang disahkan oleh Perlembagaan Persekutuan, yakni melalui peti undi untuk mendapat sokongan majoriti rakyat. Ini bersesuaian dengan prinsip bahawa rupa bentuk kerajaan hanya boleh ditentukan oleh rakyat itu sendiri. This actually explains the provisions clearly. Now, I go on again to quote you. Remember this, the court decisions have said that debates are of not much use, but I call it the promoter. The promoter speech is very important in defining the laws. And I go on. Of course, I can't speak like him, but I hope you can understand. Yeah. No, it's been the truthful. Tuan Yang Dipertua menyedari bahawa rang undang-undang ini digubal di bawah perkara 149 dan ia membenarkan penahanan individu oleh pihak polis untuk tujuan siasatan yang luar daripada norma kebiasaan tata cara jenayah dan undang-undang keterangan yang lazim. Maka kerajaan telah mengambil keputusan untuk mengadakan beberapa lindungan jamin atau safeguard dengan izin seperti berikut. This is the promise, okay? Pertamanya, melalui peruntukan Seksyen 4, tiada seorang boleh ditangkap dan ditahan di bawah seksyen ini semata-mata asal kepercayaan politiknya, which I've stated it just now. Ini membawa maksud perlindungan kepada penglibatan dalam aktiviti yang sah di sisi undang-undang melalui penyataan pendapat atau pengambilan tindakan yang dibuat menurut hukum rukun suatu parti politik pada masa itu. This has already been, I think, quoted just now. I will not waste your time. And I go on. The second jaminan. Fasal 4 perlu ditekankan di sini bahawa kuasa penangkapan dan penahanan ini adalah untuk tujuan penyiasatan semata-mata. Not for any other purpose. For investigative purpose. Orang yang ditangkap dan ditahan bahawa fasal ini boleh ditahan dalam tempoh 24 jam. Dan lepas itu 28 hari. I will not go on to read that. I will possibly bore you. And I go on to the third one. Ketiganya adalah sunset clause. Bagi tempoh tahanan 28 hari, hendaklah disemak setiap 5 tahun. Dan hendaklah terhenti berkuat kuasa, melainkan jika apabila semakan dibuat sesuatu ketetapan diluluskan oleh kedua-dua majlis parlimen untuk melanjutkan tempoh kuat kuasa peruntukan itu. Bermakna, meaning that if both parliaments, both houses pass it, then it will be. But if they didn't say anything, nothing was done, it will lapse on its own. That's just how we drafted it. Now, I go on to the fourth one. Tuan Yang di-Pertua, lindung jamin keempat ialah fasal 5 memperuntukkan bahawa apabila seorang ditangkap dan ditahan bawah fasal 4, polis yang menjalankan penyiasatan hendaklah memberitahu waris kadim atau next of kin orang yang ditangkap dan ditahan itu sesegera mungkin mengenai penangkapan dan penahannya. That means as soon as possible. Memenuhi dan polis juga, pihak polis juga hendaklah memenuhi hak mengumumi, I think, atau dengan izin right to attorney atau dengan izin right to attorney si ditahan tidak lewat daripada 48 hours. So you present it to the lawyer. Now, lindungan kelima. Lindungan jamin kelima, dalam jangka masa yang tidak lebih daripada tamatnya tempoh tahanan, pegawai polis yang menjalankan siasatan itu perlu menghantar kertas siasatan kepada pendakwa raya di mana beliau hendaklah membuat keputusan sama ada mendakwa tertuduh di bawah mahkamah atau kebebasannya atau membebaskannya. Ini berarti tidak akan ditahan selepas tempoh 28 hari. So, there is that safeguard. In those days, when they're under ISA, it was never referred to the public prosecutor. But in this case, it has to be referred for action to be taken. If not, then the person will be released. Now, lindung jamin keenam ialah apabila akta itu berkuat kuasa. Kerajaan juga akan menubuhkan satu jawatan kuasa secara pentadbiran untuk menyemak keseluruhan akta ini daripada semasa ke semasa. Dan jawatan kuasa ini akan juga bertanggungjawab untuk meneliti pelaksanaan akta tersebut dan mengemukakan syur untuk penambahbaikan. So there's supposed to be a committee administratively formed. And who are in this committee? It'll be interesting to see. Jawatan kuasa ini akan, I didn't say this. Jawatan kuasa ini akan dianggotai bukan sahaja dari agensi-agensi berkenaan tetapi juga oleh Presiden Majlis Peguam dan Suhakap. Lindung jamin terakhir dan terbesar, I didn't say this, I'm quoting. First thing, before I go to the lindungan akhir, but all I'm asking is that I think, with the greatest respect, I think these are the things that we should be asking for if you're concerned about all these aspects, okay? So you should be asking for where is the committee, can we have the committee, we have Suhakam and so on, to do the check of balances. This is something good. And that has, and I think that was a good thing that he has promised. Yes. And, yeah?
It's not happened.
Yeah, but I think sometimes you need to be reminded. I think it is up to you, Mr. President, to bring this matter up. The last one, and this is a universal jaminan, which is stated. I'm reading to you this. Kita harus... Wait. Okay. Kita harus lindungan, it says lindung jamin terakhir dan terbesar adalah kuasa dan kehendak rakyat. Kita harus maklum bahawa di tangan rakyatlah kuasa setiap 5 tahun untuk mengamanahkan parti atau gabungan parti mana yang hendak diberi kuasa sebagai kerajaan. Itulah teras asas sistem demokrasi berparlimen. I don't speak like him, but that is what I get from the handset. And I repeat that to you. And I think these are good safeguards, if you ask me. Use of Sosma. I will not go into all this. Well, of course, I'm sure you have seen Yazid Sufat's case. And of course, recently, there are 2 more arrests that have been made. That those have been charged in court. And as a professional, I will not discuss that because it will be a subject matter that is that has been brought to court and that will have to be settled in court. And as to the legality and so on, I think we will wait for the court decisions. Let's see what happens. So I will not go into what is sabotage. And however, I have these issues to raise. You see, for those two cases and so on, there are criticisms. Their criticisms are based on two grounds. Firstly, that the SOSMA was intended to deal with terrorists and terrorism only. Secondly, how does lodging reports and disclosing information about alleged mismanagement, misappropriation of funds, embezzlement, criminal breach of trust, or fraud constitute sabotage, when the whole purpose of lodging a police report is to enable the police or other law enforcement agencies to initiate investigations into complaints contained in the police report? What then of the purported protections we claim to afford whistleblowers under the Whistleblower Protection Act of 2010, which came into force on the 15th of December 2010 as part of the GTP, that is the Government Transformation Plan, and of course the NKRA, the National Key Results Area, to eliminate corruption? So these are things that you have to ponder. And as to the answers, I will not give you, because I have the greatest respect for all of you to have very sound brains. Now, the other matter, another point of contention, is how any foreign investigation instituted pursuant to those disclosures would affect Malaysia's banking and financial systems when no foreign law enforcement agency has jurisdiction to investigate an offence in Malaysia. If any foreign law enforcement agency were to initiate their own domestic investigation, it would necessarily be in relation to breaches of their own respective laws and misuse or undermining of their own banking or financial system. That is their business, as far as I'm concerned. But again, I will not give you the answer to this. The Federal Bureau of Investigation and the U.S. Department of Justice examination of Goldman Sachs' role in a series of transactions reported in the Star Business on 15th of October 2015 demonstrate my point. Ladies and gentlemen, my friend had a conclusion, so I need to have a conclusion too. But mine is very short, and I'll just divert you to another place. The necessity for special investigative and procedural powers of SOSMA has been proven to be of much use, especially in the Lahad Datu case, as well as the IS investigations. There is no doubt on that. The controversy now is the extension of its use into other security offences prescribed under the first schedule to the Act. However, the most specific issue that needs to be addressed is whether certain alleged acts constitute the particular security offence being invoked to justify the use of SOSMA. On those issues, your best advisor will be the courts. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for listening patiently to me. Thank you very much.